Let's start with the region of the femoral triangle, which you are familiar with. Now, the most superficial structures which you see here are the veins. These are the superficial veins that drain into the great saphenous vein. Of course, they are accompanied by small, tiny arteries. This vein is the superficial circumflex iliac vein, and this one is the superficial epigastric. And these are the superficial external pudendal, which go to the external genitalia. Now, these veins, they drain into the great saphenous vein, and the great saphenous vein drains into the femoral vein. This is a fresh dissection, and you can see a lot of these superficial inguinal lymph nodes. Now, going up into the lower part of the anterior abdominal wall, you can see that the superficial fascia is in the form of a fatty layer, Camper's layer, and a membranous layer, the membranous layer, or the Scarpa's fascia. The Scarpa's fascia here is incised, and I am now reflecting the Scarpa's fascia, the membranous layer of the superficial fascia of the anterior abdominal wall. You can see some of the nerves here. These are cutaneous branches, anterior cutaneous branches of intercostal nerves. Remember that here, still here, we have the intercostal nerves. The 10th, 11th, and 12th intercostal, and the subcostal nerve, and then we have the L1 nerve, which form the iliohypogastric and ilioinguinal nerves. This aponeurosis is the aponeurosis of the external oblique muscle. These are the fibers, the muscle fibers of external oblique, and you can see the direction of muscle fibers. They go downwards and medially. There is a deficiency here, medially, in the aponeurosis of the external oblique muscle. And this deficiency is a triangular deficiency, as you can see, this one. It has a medial crus and a lateral crus. So these are the two crura, and the deficiency is the superficial inguinal ring. So this is the superficial inguinal ring, and the bone that I can feel here is the pubic crest, which is located at the base of the superficial inguinal ring. Although it is called a ring, but in reality, it is a triangle. It is a triangle. Now, arising from the ring is the branch of the ilioinguinal nerve. The ilioinguinal nerve, now if I incise the external oblique aponeurosis, I can now go in to see the inside of the inguinal canal. And you can see that this is the inguinal canal, this is the ilioinguinal nerve, it traverses the inguinal canal, the ilioinguinal nerve, and appears or leaves the inguinal canal through the superficial inguinal ring. The lowermost fibers of the external oblique aponeurosis form the inguinal ligament, and this ligament also give rise to muscle fibers of the other muscles. So you can see here that the ligament which extends from the anterior superior iliac spine, this bony prominence here, to the pubic tubercle, gives rise to muscle fibers. These are the muscle fibers of the internal oblique, and they arise from the inguinal ligament. See?
Which goes upward.
And yes, see? This is the internal oblique muscle fibers. They go upwards, and they arise, the lowermost fibers, they arise from the inguinal ligament itself. Okay. Now, these fibers, they form part of the anterior wall of the inguinal canal, together with the aponeurosis of the external oblique. Okay. The floor of the inguinal canal is formed by the upturned fibers of the inguinal ligament, and you can see part of the roof. These fibers are the arching fibers that they extend from the anterior to the posterior wall of the inguinal canal to form the conjoint tendon. Now, if I split the internal oblique muscle, I can see deep to it is the fibers of the transverse abdominis. So this is the transverse abdominis fibers. Can you hold these fibers for me, please? Yes. This is the transverse abdominis fibers, and you can see the plane here. This is the neurovascular plane where the nerves are located. One of these nerves is the ilioinguinal nerve. The transverse abdominis muscle does not reach far medially as the internal oblique. So it does, so you can see the transverse abdominis muscle arises from the lateral half of the inguinal ligament, and it does not participate in the formation of the anterior wall of the inguinal canal. These fibers of the transverse abdominis are joining the fibers of the internal oblique to form the conjoint tendon. Okay, thank you. So this is the region of the conjoint tendon. This is the conjoint tendon here. It is located in the posterior wall of the inguinal canal. This is one of the contents of the inguinal canal. This is a female subject. So this is the round ligament of the uterus. And you can see that the conjoint tendon is located in the posterior wall of the canal, posterior to the round ligament of the uterus. Okay? But if we go more laterally, you can see that in this region, the posterior wall is deficient because it's only formed of the transversalis fascia. Okay? Now, so this fibrous cord which you see here, because this is a female subject, this is the round ligament of the uterus. It is the remnant of the gubernaculum, and it continues into the labium majus. It will spread and disappear as the fibers into the labium majus, passing through the superficial inguinal ring, together with the ilioinguinal nerve. Now, let's open the abdominal wall. You can see on the inside of the abdominal wall, on the inside, this is the rectus abdominis muscle, rectus abdominis, and this is the inferior epigastric. These are inferior epigastric vessels. And this fibrous structure here is the round ligament of the uterus. See that the inferior epigastric vessels are medial to that, because this is passing through the deep inguinal ring. If I will pass my forceps now through the deep inguinal ring, and it will go into, it will follow the root and will appear in the superficial, see? Mm-hmm. So this is the root taken by the testis in the male and by the round ligament in the female to pass through the inguinal canal. Okay, so this is the round ligament. I will show you how it is attached to the uterus. You can see here, this is the uterus, okay, the fundus of the uterus, and on the lateral side there's what we call the corno of the uterus, and from the corno of the uterus there's a fibrous band, a thickening here. This fibrous band is the round ligament of the uterus. This fibrous band, if I will follow it, it is this one. See? Oh. It is this one, it's the same. This is the round ligament, passes through the deep inguinal ring, lateral to the inferior epigastric artery. In the male, it supplies the inferior epigastric at this position, it supplies a cremasteric artery. And it, in addition to that, it's, the inferior epigastric artery supplies a pubic branch. This is the pubic branch of the inferior epigastric artery. Okay? And this pubic branch is large in some subjects. It is large and forms an aberrant obturator artery, replaces the obturator artery. Okay, this is the site of the lacunar ligament here. And this part of tissue is the peritoneum. This is the peritoneum. See, this is the peritoneum here. This is the parietal peritoneum. Okay, and fascia, the endoabdominal fascia, this is the fascia, and in between the fascia and the peritoneum, you can see that there is fatty tissue and soft tissue, and this is what we call the extraperitoneal fatty tissue or connective tissue. So these are all the layers of the that form the anterior abdominal wall. You can see here, in this region, these are the obturator nerve, then the artery and the obturator vein. And you can see the obturator artery here, it anastomoses with the pubic branch of the inferior epigastric artery. But we still have an obturator artery from its normal or usual origin. So this is not an abnormal obturator artery. It's just a pubic branch of the inferior epigastric artery. You can see this is the superficial inguinal ring, the ilioinguinal nerve arising from it, and this is the round ligament of the uterus. It's taking a covering, and in the male it's called the external spermatic fascia, taking a covering from the aponeurosis of the external oblique muscle. Again, you can see here that arising from the inguinal ligament is the muscle fibers of the internal oblique muscle arise from it. This is the posterior wall of the inguinal canal. But it is formed of transversalis fascia here in the region of the inguinal triangle. While more medially here, this is the conjoint tendon. You can see the difference in the thickening. This is a thin part. This part is the weak area that predisposes for the direct inguinal hernia. Okay, because it is only the transversalis fascia which is located here. Just to remind you of the vessels, this is the external iliac vein, which is formed by the femoral vein, and this is the external iliac artery, which forms the femoral artery, and you can see the tendon of the muscle here. Which muscle is this one? That is the psoas. And on the surface of the psoas, major muscle, is the nerve. This is the genitofemoral. You can see that the genitofemoral nerve here is splitting into a genital branch and a femoral branch. The femoral branch will supply the skin over the femoral triangle, and the genital branch will accompany the structures that pass through the deep inguinal ring, including here in this subject, this is the round ligament. Lateral to the psoas major muscle is the femoral nerve itself. So you can see these three structures will form the contents of the femoral triangle later on, from medial to lateral. Here the vein, it will form the femoral vein, or it is the continuation of the femoral vein, and the artery will form the femoral artery, and then most laterally is the nerve. But you can observe from this dissection that the nerve is outside the fascia. This is the fascia, the endoabdominal fascia. Here it is the psoas fascia. The nerve is outside the fascia, but the vessels are inside the fascia. Extension of the fascia will form the femoral sheath. So the femoral sheath contains the femoral vein, femoral artery, but does not contain the femoral nerve.